all over MSNBC. Almost every one of their hosts, almost all those clips were from MSNBC, not from Fox News. Mm-hmm. None of them were from Fox News. They're all MSNBC. They all can't be Bernie, can't be Bernie. Here, let's bring in Congress in Missouri, telling everybody they should be Republican light. Hey, everybody, remember those tax cuts? They're precious goddamn tax cuts. Oh, and I can't be Bernie because he actually fights for the average guy. We got more. Matt did a wonderful job here. I'm so proud of you, Matt. Wonderful work here. Let's give you the next clip.
Socialism has been a manifest disaster.
Alec would still be here today if I had known that I could come to Canada.
Alec Smith died after trying to ration a vial of insulin when he couldn't afford. worried someone's going to quit the game because they can't find land. How bad for them.
Civilians in Iraq is the same thing as whether you like the Packers or the Cowboys. So, now look, on the one hand, I sympathize with Alan. She's trying to be a decent human being, and if we just yell at each other nonstop, yes, that's the problem, right? And I get that George Bush in person is probably a guy that is easy to get along with, but that's because he's not killing your kids. And I can go on and on, right? And so, you got to separate that out.
I wonder what South Park's gonna be tonight.
Yeah.
had something really funny happen. Just had something really funny happen in my game. Someone thought they were hot shit. Someone thought they were hot shit because they could play a blocker during my turn. They were like, don't forget flash, motherfucker, surprise. And I just replied, don't forget death touch, motherfucker, you can't block because it'll die. I'm like, oh, thank you for the reminder. I will not block. I just thought it was really funny.
That and my elbow pops.
Yay. It's so weird to watch that show and then play fairies. Just saying.
Thank you.
Yay, progress. Did you use the oils?
I grew up in Colombia. I grew up in Bogota.
Yeah.
I still spend a lot of time there, but I left full-time Bogota in 2004 or so. And living there shaped me as wanting to do something for the world, for other people. My parents were both people who always taught me that that was the best way in which you could find happiness, actually. It's exactly what you said.
Oh, look at that.
Yeah.
Okay. So now, designforwildlife.org is your website. Who should go there? Is it people who are looking to design things for wildlife, or like what, like, you see what I'm saying?
Yes, so it's really made for wildlife conservation organizations.
Okay.
So I work with organizations like Wild Aid.
So TYT hasn't posted the thing with Kevin Smith last night? I'm starting to worry that something went wrong.
And they could use a hand in developing services for communities that
they work with. It's gonna be fine.
And fundraising, because we could get a lot.
Jinx said he was going to confront Kevin on something.
Right. And you do fundraising for those organizations?
Like something where he'd slighted him before?
Design a project around how can we get more people to fund more conservation work.
Maybe he caught Kevin on a bad day.
3% of all donations in the United States go to anything else but animals. There's 3% that go to animals.
So one of my opponents is Rock the Arab, and another one is Jesus of Nazareth.
97% of that is coming from the United States.
Oh, wow.
Think about that for a second. That 1% comes from the U.S. funds 93% of all wildlife conservation projects worldwide. All
right. So you can make a big difference.
Do a lot more.
All right. Mariana, thanks so much for joining us. Designforwildlife.org. Thank you for coming in. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much. It was great to be here.
All right. Bye. All right. When we come back, back to current day politics. So we'll discuss the disaster that's Trump and Giuliani. Join me now is Alex Nazarian. He is a national correspondent for Yahoo News. He's also the author of The Best People, Trump's Cabinet, and the Siege on... pretty sure The Best People is a little sarcastic, to say at least. Alex, welcome to the Young Turks.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no problem. So I want to get to your book in a second because it's actually very relevant to what's happening today. But you also have an interview with Rudy Giuliani, and that's always a wild ride. So before I even get into the substance of it, I'm going to ask a funny question here. So out of all the different news outlets, how did you get Giuliani to talk to you?
I called him on the telephone.
So if I called him on the phone, would he go on a rampage with me too? Is he doing that these days?
I think the short answer is I'm sure he talked to you. He's trying to make his case, so he's talking to a lot of people. And as you know from your time as a New Yorker, Rudy has always loved to talk. Now, what he has talked about has changed considerably in the many years since he has been, mayor of New York. But he's still combative, argumentative, so he can be abrasive, obviously, but he loves to talk. I actually just spoke to him a couple hours ago. He was getting into D.C., and he said he wasn't sure if he would be able to comply with Lindsey Graham's request that he come and testify in the Senate. He said he'd have to check with his client, that client
Joey's. Jellies.
They have their own media outlets, just like the left has media outlets, and those are feeding this narrative. And Giuliani, look, I'm not going to diagnose him, I'm not going to diagnose anyone, but I do believe there is a method here, and I, this is in my book. I believe there's been a method to Trumpism all along. I'm not endorsing the method, I'm not criticizing it, but I do believe there is a method. And remember, Jake, Giuliani did much the same thing in the Mueller probe, where he was saying things that seemed utterly outrageous, but that worked well with the base.
Okay, I like that we're having a mini BBC moment.
Yeah.
Okay, I got kids too. And Ryan Grimm actually puts them on his lap when we're doing the interview. So, Alex, but it's a great point that you're making about the base and how they're appealing to it in Trumpism. But it's interesting, and I'm not sure that I fully agree about whether it's a strategy. So let's dive into that, and that goes to your book. Theme as well. So, what do you think is the strategy that they're using that could potentially be politically savvy, even if you don't agree?
I think the strategy is not. I think it's instinctual. I think it's driven by Trump's uncanny ability to understand the media cycle, which is one of his true gifts. And he spins everything up into a chaos, and that chaos is intolerable to the vast majority of people. I mean, most people can't take this level of breaking news every day, these seemingly incredible revelations. But Trump actually thrives in this. Not only that, but his government is doing plenty of things while Trump was on Ukraine. What did, Kurt Volker say? What did Sondland say? While we're looking at that, the rest of the government isn't sitting there checking Twitter. It's doing the job that he promised he would do. It's privatizing federal lands. It's expanding oil and gas rights. It's rolling back protections in education. Now, some people may agree with that, but what I think is worth studying is how little attention we're paying to that work. They're installing judges, dozens and dozens of judges, that we simply are not able to pay attention to. So I think it's a shock and awe strategy. If you talk to the likes of Steve Bannon, he'll say that just, they will all but say, this is how we want. This is how we have always wanted to run things. Now, look, that could be revisionism. But even if it is, I think it's not an inaccurate description of what has happened in this administration, which is they've utterly overwhelmed our ability to follow along.
So, Alex, there's a lot of truth to that. In fact, today we did a story about how Betsy DeVos is a contemporary because there's 160,000 students who are forgiven from scam private colleges, and she just won't forgive them. She just keeps sending them bills and in a sense, literally robbing them. And so that's happening while, some people are distracted. But one more question, at least, that's again, relevant to today. So Trump, I think, again, to the core of your book, my theory is that he picks people like a mob boss does, not based on competence, but based on loyalty. Because if you're doing things that are wrong, loyalty is a more important trait for you than being really competent in your job. But he does not return the loyalty. So there's a long list of people under Trump's bus. Jeff Sessions, Michael Cohen's in prison. I mean, Giuliani is very confident that Trump's going to stick by him. Really? Ask his former lawyer, who's, in a penitentiary. So, I can list literally two dozen other people that he's thrown under the bus. So is there a point where that breaks and Mitch McConnell goes and talks to his caucus and goes, guys, we're next. So let's take him out before he takes us out.
Jake, that's an excellent point. And I want to just say I genuinely enjoyed this conversation. You've asked really good questions. But to answer that question, no. Not only you mentioned McConnell, the judges are his raison d'etre, and that's what if Trump has done nothing else, he's been terrific for the right on judges. He's rolled back every regulation, but he's certainly tried to roll back as many regulations as possible. So I don't see it. I mean, Giuliani and McConnell are too crafty, too good at politics to think that. Trump would ever be loyal to them. They understand. I do think some people around him understand the nature of this relationship, but others, like Pruitt, did not, which is why they fell by the wayside. They thought the loyalty would be reciprocated when it clearly was never going to be, and Trump would jettison them as soon as it became necessary to do so. But Rudy knows the game he's playing. McConnell knows. I think some of the lesser figures don't, and they're clearly learning. And some of them, like Michael Cohen, are learning in prison. So.
Obviously,
I can watch the screensaver all night.
What?
I can watch this screensaver all night.
Continue to cover what this
Someone thinks they're about to win. I don't think they're about to. I think they're about to lose, actually. You okay? Sorry. I love you.
Thank you.